press, I want the ball, and they write books about it and stuff like that. And, you know, that's really, it hasn't been our team, and it hasn't been the Michigan tradition. You know, the Michigan tradition is when you win, there's enough there for everybody, and that's really what's happened for this team.
And I think that's just another indication of how unselfish this Michigan football team is.
That's the way they played all year, Don. And all of these postseason honors that we're receiving, including Woodson winning the Heisman Trophy, are as a result of the success of this team playing together and winning.
All right, we've got a lot more for you coming up from the Rose Bowl. This is just part of what you're going to see.
This is the second long march by Michigan in the third quarter. The other to a field goal. This one,
we'll look back at some memorable moments in Bo's Rose Bowl career, explain what Mount Everest has to do with this Michigan team. Guy Gordon explores that relationship. And the Cougars are a cocky bunch. Some have even ripped the Wolverines. Jay Berry has that story when we continue from Southern California. Kind of to you, has it?
Well, my first Rose Bowl, 1970, I didn't even make it to the sideline. I had a heart attack the night before, and we lost that game. That should have told me that I was going to have trouble out here.
And, of course, right over your shoulder here, down here at the goal line.
3-yard line. Charles White never got further with the ball than the 3-yard line.
And they called it a touchdown.
And they called it a touchdown.
How could they do that?
And we recovered the ball.
Has to be maybe the most controversial call in college football and maybe the worst call in college football.
It was the worst call that I ever had in a game that was a critical call. Mm-hmm. And then right out here in the last Rose Bowl when I made a fool of myself on the sideline.
Well, you almost tripped over the headphones.
For the first time in my career, I call a successful fake punt. We run the ball from midfield down to the 20, and the guy calls holding on my right tackle, and he hardly touched the guy.
It was a bad call.
It was a bad call.
There were some good moments for you, though, here, right?
Right. There was a third down and 25 on that 20 against Washington, and I called a draw play, a real smart call, and my coaches were absolutely having a fit, and Butch Wolfolk broke up there for 27 yards in the first down, and we went on down to score. And so we had a couple games where we played real well and enjoyed it. But the other games that we lost by a touchdown or less. Mm-hmm. I mean, we were always in the games, and they were tight, but I never had a great success out here, no.
How about the feeling that Lloyd Carr must have? His first Rose Bowl game as the head coach of Michigan.
Oh, my gosh. And think about it, coming in here number one in the nation. Now, that is pressure. And there's no question about it. But it's a great opportunity for the Michigan team. We came in here undefeated. We were ranked like fifth in the nation. There were four undefeated teams ranked ahead of us. But to come in here with a chance to be the national champion is unbelievable.
This game, in specific kind of fashion, strategy, Michigan, Washington State, what should we be looking for?
Well, the thing to look for is I think our linebackers are going to have to do a great job because they have dual responsibility. One, on the short passes with a back coming out of the backfield or in the instances in which they use a tight end, our linebackers must be able to run with them. That's why Jones and Gold are going to have to play great games. They're both gifted guys that can run and have ball skills, and they have to play a great game. Plus, they also have to shut down the draw plays. I think the draw plays could beat us because if they mount a running attack then and balance it with their passing attack, we could lose the game. We must deny the run because in my career and since I've retired at Michigan, I don't think I've ever seen a pure passing team ever beat us. Mm-hmm.
There's something about a running team and a passing team when you have time off. That Washington State may have a little advantage here, right?
I maintain that, and you're absolutely right, Don, because you can get your coordination. You can run your routes. You can get it back quicker if you're throwing the ball most of the time than you can when you have to have intricate timing and blocking up front for a running game. I've always felt that the disadvantage we had coming out of the Midwest, we were powerful running teams, but we were not the skilled passing teams that could get all that rhythm back that quickly. And that's the problem that Michigan will face. How they run the ball, can they get their timing, can they execute those blocks, which is much more difficult than it is to take a three-step drop and to throw to receivers.
Should Lloyd Carr be concerned about how certain players react in a game of this magnitude? I know Ohio State's big. I know Penn State's big. Yeah. I know
all those big. But you're in your hometown. You're in your home area.
Right. This is totally different in how players would react to this kind of a moment. Is it not?
It is. And we don't know that, except we know that Michigan has a team of great character. They've played together hard all year long. I don't see any reason why they wouldn't give the same performance out here. I don't think that they're going to come in here feeling that they got to have some breaks to win. I think that they think they got the best team, and no matter what this Washington State does or how much success they have passing, that they're going to win the game. I just feel that's the way they'll go in there.
Okay. More with Bo. More on Michigan and Washington State. The time Michigan won the national championship was in 1948. The closest the Wolverines have come since was 1985 under Bo Schembechler, when Michigan beat Nebraska 27-23 in the Fiesta Bowl to finish number two in both polls. One of the things in which you might not be familiar concerning the motivating factors on this football team, Lloyd Carr used an ice pick and an author. Guy Gordon explains what I'm talking about.
Mount Everest is a life and death situation. I think there are some similarities in challenging a great football schedule, which we did.
While others picked this team to finish fourth or fifth in the conference, Lloyd Carr knew in August he had a team of potential champions. The key was motivating them, taking them to the next level that he was certain they could reach. He seized on the Everest theme and called veteran mountaineer Lucas Siski to help them start this climb and face this daunting challenge.
How many people get the opportunity to face the ultimate of challenges? And the rewards from that are going to be much more satisfying than if they had an easy schedule.
Kosicki knows about ultimate challenges. He was on Everest in May of 1996 when an expedition fell into ruin. Eight climbers died, including Lou's two team leaders. They made the mistake of summiting too late in the day and were caught in a storm. Using his experience and sound judgment, Lou turned around, denying himself his dream of summiting the world's tallest peak. It was a personal tragedy for Lou, but one leaving him with valuable lessons to pass on.
Managing the emotions, self-control, inner strength, that is what makes the difference in the mountains. And I thought that very well may be the factor that makes the difference on the football field.
This season really depended on the decisions that we made as we tried to climb that mountain. You know, not even just decisions on the field, but decisions off the field, personal decisions, and how we handled ourselves in the classroom and just being out in society.
Their mountain became conquerable because Lou taught them to view the climb as merely a series of steps.
So Michigan, time lead, forget it.
If the goal for the day is to climb 2,000 feet, we don't think of it as climbing 2,000 feet because it overwhelms you. You think of it as climbing 100 feet 20 times. During the game, they're focusing play by play.
Yard by yard.
Yard by yard. It was a very intense focus, and we spent a lot of time talking about that.
Carr gave each player and Kosicki a pickaxe to symbolize the struggle ahead.
He really illustrated teamwork. And for Lou, teamwork, counting on the guy ahead of you, counting on the guy pulling his end of the rope, counting on that guy, he had to pay with his life if that guy didn't do his responsibility. We don't have to do something as extreme as pay for our life, but we'll lose if guys on the team don't do their responsibility.
His talk lasted an hour, but their questions lasted an hour and a half. They were deep, thoughtful, insightful, and told Lou everything he needed to know about their character, that these were men he would gladly climb with.
These are the kind of people who are going to succeed at this challenge because they will be able to manage all of what it takes to endure the hardships. There was no question in my mind at that moment that these guys were going to the top. They're going all the way.
Lou's home is filled with mementos of peaks he's conquered, and now it is joined by a symbol of a climb he has, in a small way, helped lead.
I've stood on top of the biggest and most significant mountains of the world, but I thought I was standing on top in Ann Arbor, Michigan after the Ohio State game. That meant as much to me as standing on top of any other mountain.
But there is one more mountain to climb, and it's a big one. And when you get this close to the peak, like this team is, the air is very thin, the pressure is very intense. Lou knows. He was just 300 feet away from his goal. He could almost reach out and touch it. But he had to turn back because of the mistakes of others. This team knows if they limit their own mistakes, they can reach their peak. They're confident if they do that, come Thursday night, there will be a golden block M atop the summit of college football. Don?
Thank you, Guy. That truly is a very inspirational story. And imagine what it must be like, the monstrous headaches you could get trying to move an entire football program out to the West Coast to play in the Rose Bowl. Obviously, it's a problem that Michigan would like to have every year. It's something that our Dave Llewellyn took a look at. Dave?
Don, John Falk is the equipment manager for the Michigan football team. He's been on his share of Rose Bowl trips in his 24 years at the school, so he's no doubt seen some of the beauty this area offers. But he spends most of his time in the equipment room, locker rooms, and on the practice field.
Falk had the responsibility to see that the equipment and other gear necessary to outfit and care for the team made it from Ann Arbor to the West Coast.
They can't miss you coming to this thing.
No, huh? We get a lot of reactions when we go down the highway on our road trip, I can tell you that.
This is his 11th Rose Bowl.
You have to think way ahead. We have a list. I have an elaborate list of everything that we check off, that we pack, the things that we need in Ann Arbor, the things we're going to need in Pasadena, the things that are going to combine together from Ann Arbor to Pasadena. And now you also have to think about what you're going to need at the next junior college and then from the junior college on to the Rose Bowl.
The players' helmets and shoulder pads were flown to Southern California. The semi-truck met the plane at the airport, and all was in readiness when the team arrived for practice. Some years back in Pasadena, the Wolverines had a number of game jerseys stolen.
Fortunately, I had three sets of game jerseys. I had one set that was packed away, and nobody knew where they were. They did eventually did catch the people that broke in. But, that's why you had to bring so many things. I got about three sets of game jerseys. I got two sets of practice jerseys and two sets of pants, just in case something would happen.
It's a big undertaking when you've got 112 football players to care for. Practice uniforms must be washed and dried, ankles must be taped, and injuries treated.
This here's the training room here. Paul Schmidt's in charge of this. And all these items are brought out, all the mouth guards. I think he's got like four sets of mouth guards for each kid on the team.
After 5 days of practice at Saddleback College, the Wolverines packed up again and moved north to Pasadena. Falk is familiar with the routine, but it's a new experience for these Michigan players who earned their first Big Ten championship ring this season.
Every game, I'd always walk around with my fist in the air, and I tell the kids, this is what we're fighting for. And after the Wisconsin game, every kid came in, they all grabbed my hand and said, Big John, we got one.
As you might imagine, it is an expensive trip. The Rose Bowl covers the costs for the participating teams. Michigan's tab is over $1 million.
Without question, college athletics is big business. These bowl games certainly illustrate that. Everyone's role is important, from the players and coaches who you'll see on the field during the telecast, to John Falk, his staff, and the other support personnel who help make this program what it is. Don?
Thank you, Davey. Coming up next, a look at those Washington State Cougars. They are dangerous with a terrific quarterback. And later on in the program, the captain, the injured man who hopes to play one more play, Eric Mays. That and more as the Big Ten Ticket continues from Pasadena.
You know, traveling contingents down to that game, in the history of the game, I know there's so many people that have been waiting and aren't going to miss this opportunity to go.
Throw a score at me.
For the Rose Bowl?
Yeah.
Oh, man.
You can do that.
All right, well, I say the Cougs will win
24-14. Ooh, listen
to all of you. Well, like I said, what am I going to say?
Welcome back to the Rose Bowl. Michigan is anywhere from a 7 to 8 point favorite to win this game, but it should have nothing to do with the rich tradition and history of the Michigan football program. Yet that's very difficult to ignore.
Michigan has won more games than any other school and played in a bowl game the past 23 years. Washington State has gone to 6 postseason games in its 103-year history. Michigan has not had a losing record in 30 years. The Cougars have had 5 losing seasons during the 90s.
And think of this, the Cougars have sold out all their home games this year, played to over 200,000 people. Michigan plays to more than that in just 2 games, but they don't believe that that small town image will have any effect at all on the outcome of this football game. Jay Berry has been covering Washington State, and he joins us from the Coliseum. Jay?
Don, when I played at the University of Wyoming, the school was a few Cowboys more than 8,000, while the town, Laramie, had about 17,000 people. It's just the opposite for Washington State, a school of 17,000, and Pullman's last census showed about 8,000 people. Whether the Cougars know this or not, they can show that the strength of a team is not reflected in the size of its student body, which is what we always felt, or the town's lack of traffic jams.
So the Cougars' mission is a little more involved than most, but you'll hear no complaints. In fact, they like their role and are playing up their position.
We're the Cinderella story, you know, you can't say anything about it. You know, that's what we are. We're in the position right now to do that. And, you know, you could say we're the Northwestern of like 94.
David and Goliath all the way, no question about it. They've got all the things that it takes. They've got all the money, the tradition, the facilities.
Price and Lee, different people, but both are good at trying to put the pressure on Michigan. And it's no accident that their pregame rhetoric sounds so similar. They are as close as a coach and player can be, and that has spilled over to the rest of the team as well.
You know, everybody looks out for everybody's back, and somebody's down, they help them up, and we get going. That's just the way this team has been. It's a family, and you watch your family's back.
Watching Leaf's back is his girlfriend, Shannon Wyckoff. She is quick to tell you, not only does she play on the Cougars volleyball team, she knows a thing about football as well.
I taught him everything he knows, but other than that...
How about your girlfriend? Any ideas of marriage?
Let's get to the meat of it.
I'm just down here for the roles. Don't put me on the spot like that. She's over there just eating it up, probably. But
she didn't tell me to ask you.
Okay, good.
It's the only time Leaf shows a hint of nervousness, but he quickly recovers when quizzed about Charles Woodson.
He's a tremendous football player, but he cannot guard 5 fabulous receivers.
They walk the walk, talk the talk, and produce game-winning numbers. 184 receptions, over 3,200 yards, and 29 touchdowns.
We're not even worrying about Woodson. That's him. We go into the game, he's just like any other DB. We play in the Pac-10. You know, they play man coverage all year. That's all we face all year. We feel like Brian Kelly from USC and other DBs at Arizona State, you know, they're just as good as Woodson, you know, as far as athletic ability and man-on-man coverage. That's all they do. So, I mean, we're not even worrying about Woodson. We just go try to execute and do what we know best.
Our goal is to go to the Rose Bowl and win it. And a lot of teams don't put that down. A lot of teams put down, you know, to go to the Rose Bowl, and they never add that last step, you know, to win it. And that's the main objective in the minds of every player out on this field.
Live small, but play big. It's made for a winning combination for these Cougars, leading to this dream season, one that folks from Ann Arbor to Pullman can appreciate. Don?
Thank you, Jay. Of course, Ryan Leaf deserves all the attention and all the publicity surrounding this game. He was a Heisman Trophy finalist, but don't forget Ryan Greasy. Don't underrate him. He could be equally as important to Michigan winning this game as Leaf is to the Cougars winning. I talked to Greasy about this game and this moment.
You always hope and dream that you'll be able to play in a game like this, but in the back of your mind, you say, well, it's a long shot. You know, out of all of the people that play football and all the people that play in college, how many have an opportunity to play in a game like this? And it's very few. So I feel fortunate, and I want to make the most of my opportunities.
Ryan Greasy probably never expected to be in this position. Last year, he was reduced to Scott Drysback's backup and a pooch punter. His future looked bleak. Why come back for a 5th year and basically sit on the bench? But then, Drysback got hurt. Greasy stepped in, played well, and with the NFL not likely in his future, Ryan decided another year of college was more appealing than getting a job. Just imagine how Brian would feel now if he was watching the Rose Bowl on TV instead of quarterbacking the Wolverines.
No matter what game you're playing in, it's the last game of your career, playing with your friends that have been there with you for 4 or 5 years. And it's sad in a way, but hopefully that'll all be overridden by the joy that we'll have after this game.
Brian Griese has done everything Lloyd Carr has asked of him all season long. He hopes he is quietly efficient one more time on New Year's Day. When we come back, the single most important player in this football game, we'll talk with him. That, of course, is Charles Woodson. That and more when the Big Ten Ticket continues from Pasadena.
This is perfect.
Hey, Bo, what are you doing over there?
Not enough.
Bo looks a little busy right now. When he's done, he'll join us again.
That's my spot right there.
Welcome back to the Rose Bowl. I think Michigan fans have truly been blessed to see a player of Charles Woodson's caliber for the past 3 years. Woodson's story is simply remarkable. I'm talking about from infancy until now.
Charles Woodson is, in some ways, an unlikely athletic star. As a youngster, he needed corrective braces to help him walk and special shoes to fix his club feet. When he was 4, the braces were gone, and the tackling and sock football games with his brother Terry began. Little Charles has blossomed into the best defensive player in the country, a top-5 NFL draft pick should he turn pro after the Rose Bowl and the Heisman Trophy win.
From Michigan, Charles Woodson.
Since that moment, Woodson has called himself a pioneer. That is an accurate description, because clearly, Charles takes calculated gambles on the field, is not afraid of failing, and has a confidence others admire and respect.
It was so great for this to happen to my son, and I just was just overwhelmed.
I looked into her eyes, I seen her crying, you know, had to give her a big hug. I mean, that's my mother, man. She's always been there for me, done so much of my life, and I'm happy that we can bring this award home.
Charles has an incredibly close relationship with his mom. She was there to carry him and make him feel better when kids teased him about his corrective shoes. She was there to make sure he did his homework before going out to play. She's the one who made the ham sandwiches and had her children sit down in the living room for a picnic where they discussed a variety of topics. And she's the one who will decide with Charles if the NFL is next up for him, something Charles doesn't want to think about quite yet.
College is fun. I mean, you really don't have any worries in college. I mean, you always hear the horror stories about the NFL and that it's so business-like and everything's just business structured. I mean, college football is just kind of free will, and that would be something that I have to consider after the game.
Would your decision change at all based on whether or not the team wins or loses?
No, it doesn't matter about the game. It's just other things that factor in.
Some would say that if you win, and you win the national championship and you've done everything else, that there would be little else to come back for, that you would then reasonably turn pro.
Well, how about winning it again?
Could you do all that again?
I hope so. If I came back, I hope I could win it all.
Even repeat the Heisman Trophy thing, huh?
Hey, why not?
He is an incredible kid.
Lloyd Carr realizes Woodson's a once-in-a-lifetime player to coach. He's seen both sides of his personality, when Woodson's boastful and when he's quiet and humble. This is a kid who came to Michigan and thought they'd go undefeated every year and who's never won a championship at any level. That's one reason why this team, this season, this game is so special.
We have a chance to win it all. I mean, how many people can say that they won a national championship? This will be the first time we've won it in, 50 years? And, we know that team will be out there, and hopefully after the game, we can do a little partying with that team.
Charles Woodson would like nothing better than to party with all his teammates. A huge decision for Woodson coming up. Lots of controversy surrounding it. If Charles Woodson was your son, would you tell him to go pro or come back to Michigan?
Well, I don't need the money. He wouldn't need it either. So I'd advise him to come back. But I think that's a decision that he's going to have to make. And, Don, let's put it this way. If he goes, we're going to pat him on the back and wish him the best, because he's had a great career and we've enjoyed watching him play. If he comes back, then with all the other guys coming back on defense at Michigan, we could put together probably the greatest defense Michigan has ever had, period.
One young guy who you know is going to be back is linebacker Dahani Jones. He's an incredibly articulate, intelligent young man. You'll hear from Dahani coming up from Pasadena.
2 in the country at the end of the regular season. Notre Dame was number 1 after a 38-7 win over Southern Cal. But when the Wolverines destroyed the Trojans 49-0 in the Rose Bowl, the voters decided Michigan was worthy of the national title. Welcome back to the Rose Bowl. I think sometimes we hear too much about the sordid side of college athletics, the bad stuff that goes on, and you don't hear enough about the nice human interest stories. There's a kid on the Michigan football team who's a young linebacker. He is not your typical athlete who also happens to be a student.
Hold on, honey. Stay up.
When that day comes, January 1st, 4:30 Eastern Standard Time, everything's gonna let loose from my body. I'm just gonna fly around. It's gonna be like one time I was sophomore year in high school in a championship game and I got an interception. I was running so fast I thought I was gonna trip over my own feet.
Don't bet on Dahani Jones tripping or messing up in any way. He has become so good, so fast, and it's not just because of his athletic ability. Jones is an extremely intelligent player. Football is not the most important thing in his life.
My focus was always academics, and football is more of a release of stress because I was a pretty bad kid when I was younger. I mean, I didn't get into like trouble, like stealing or beating up people, but I was just like, I always had a habit of like talking back to people and like getting in fights with older people because young kids didn't even talk to me. They didn't like me, you know? So I'd always get in arguments with like teachers.
Dahani is a good kid now who doesn't argue with Lloyd Carr. He says that during finals week, his mom called him one morning four times before 8 a.m. and said, get up and study. This is a guy who isn't taking pre-NFL courses.
I want to be a pediatric neuroplastic surgeon and work with kids. And one of my great inspirations, I read the book Gifted Hands by Ben Carson. Read it about in 45 minutes. It was a long book, but I just sped through because, you know, one of the things, when it grabs you, it grabs you.
So you obviously have an affinity for kids and helping kids.
Yeah, I love kids. Every time I walk into a room and there's a little kid, he always finds a way to look at me. And I always feel like I'm attracted and I can see them. And I don't have any problem getting down on the ground and playing with a little baby, you know, or getting down on the ground, you know, to the height of a three-year-old as he runs around and tries to tackle me, you know. I don't have any problem with that. And I would love to give the chance to a child to continue in their life if they may have a neurological problem or if they, you know, may have a disorder that you need to correct by plastic surgery or any such things as that. You know, you can't go through life without giving back, and that's the way I wish I could give back to people.
And while Dahani still has a number of years left to play for Michigan, the same cannot be said for Captain Eric Mays. He, of course, is injured. He is hoping to be able to get onto that field for one more play.
I'm definitely going to dress for this game. I'm going to have the opportunity to lead the team, the 118 team at Michigan, onto the field for the Rose Bowl, so that's a great honor in itself.
So you're going to dress. You're going to whisper in a coach's ears, like, put me in just for a play or something like that?
Yeah, I don't know. That's something that you whisper into his ear late into the fourth quarter, hopefully, you know. But I'm definitely happy to be able to dress and put on that winged helmet again.
Obviously, the score of the game will dictate whether or not Lloyd Carr puts Mays in for one play. If Michigan's comfortably ahead, Carr will have the luxury of fulfilling another dream for his injured captain.
Rose Bowl game. Give me a prediction and a score. What do you think?
A score? Somebody's up, somebody's down. At the end of four quarters.
You're afraid to say anything, aren't you?
Not at all. a prediction, an expectation. We go into this game expecting to win. But a prediction, can't give.
All week long, Mays walked around the practice field, encouraging teammates, trying to feel as much a part of the team as he could. And Eric's such a positive person that should he not play and the Wolverines win, that'll be just fine.
There are guys who want to just say, let's just win the Rose Bowl, and that's fine. Let's just be Washington State. That's fine. Let's win the national championship. That's also fine, because those are all winning the same thing. And if we do any of those, I mean, we'll have won the Rose Bowl for those guys. We'll have won the national championship for the other guys. You know, and we'll have beat Washington State for the other guys. So it's definitely, it's out there.
To be a Michigan Wolverine is great. To be a Michigan Wolverine is great. To be a Michigan Wolverine is great.
Eric Mays,
What a marvelous kid. And of course, Eric was involved in all of the activities the Michigan football team took part in over the last couple of weeks out here. They had a blast. We'll show you some of it coming up from Pasadena. You know, I've been fortunate to cover a lot of Rose Bowls, and I don't think that any Michigan team has had as much fun being out here on the West Coast as this team. Most of the players went to the Great Western Forum one night to see former Wolverine Maurice Taylor, a Clipper rookie, play against the Lakers. So what do you think, huh? Wolverines in the Rose Bowl, I know you care.
Oh, no doubt, we're national champs. You know, I've been bragging all month on them. You know, they're playing real well right now, and they're doing the things that it takes to win. You know, they had the best player in college football, and, you know, I guess they got the best team in college football.
Maurice will be on the sidelines New Year's Day, rooting for his football buddies. One of them, linebacker Sam Sword, grabbed my mic and played reporter.
Will we see the Heisman pose in the Rose Bowl? That's what America wants to know.
That's why people got to keep their televisions on. You know what I'm saying? I can't tell you what I'm going to do, but I can show you when the game's on.
These guys sure had fun and certainly took a lot of pictures, but not everyone was snapping Maurice.
Now, be honest. Are you here to see him or are you here to see the Laker girls?
I'm here to see the Laker girls.
The Laker girls are quite the attraction, but senior offensive lineman Zach Adamy talked to me about some other Los Angeles sights he'll remember.
We went and saw, you know, all the stars and, you know, handprints and all that stuff.
Did you put your hands down and try to see and all that?
Yeah, we went and checked out Arnie's handprints and Marilyn Monroe. Yeah, and Marilyn Monroe, I mean, her feet were only about 2 inches long. They're probably about that long. Yeah.
So that's, you know, I mean, obviously that's stuff that you would not have had a chance to do.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, just trying to make sure we got all the opportunity in the world to do all this stuff.
Was all that pretty neat? I mean, were you kind of amazed by all that a little bit? Oh. Stuff you've heard about for a lot of years and never seen?
Oh, yeah, it was amazing. I always heard about Man's Chinese Theater. You know, you got to go here. And it was really exciting.
Is there any place else you want to go or want to see badly?
I'd like to see Beverly Hills, Rodeo Drive, and kind of want to go see Venice Beach and all the bodybuilders and stuff.
are you big into that, seeing those kind of guys and doing that or not?
No, but I mean, I'd like to see it, you know. I've always heard about Venice Beach, so yeah. I got to go check that out.
Now, Rodeo Drive, that could be a little expensive, you.
I ain't going to buy anything. I'm from Arkansas. I don't need any of that stuff.
Oh, what do you mean? They have money in Arkansas. You got some money. Yeah. You can buy a little something.
And they don't have fishing gear and stuff there, you know. Hunting gear.
If it got down to a personal thing, if they rushed the stage, I'd just have to knock a couple of the guys out.
Is that right? So,
people think athletes are stupid. They got it. The Kierkegaard references and the whole. They were like that. They were on top of it. Plus, I got big money on them, so.
Oh, do you?
Yeah. Mortgage the house.
Are you certain that they're going to win?
Sure, I'm certain that they're going to win.
They're going to win,
damn it!
It's nothing better than having information on people and using it against them. Like something I have on you, by the way.
Oh, which is what, Scott?
Something about last night in L.A. that you were at some kind of place called Wacky Bosoms or something like that. What was it called?
No,
Ixnay on the bosom A. I can say bosoms, can I?
I don't think my wife is going to appreciate that, by the way.
Oh, that's right. Okay, sorry. My fault. My wife's not going to appreciate it either, because we had the best time, didn't we?
Whoa!
Some of the material was a little nasty, but what do you expect from an L.A. comedy club? The players didn't seem to mind at all.
Well, something a little different during Rose Bowl week, eh?
Yeah, it was real different, but it was good, you know, to kind of loosen everyone up so everyone won't have a tight buttocks.
I personally do not think the Wolverines are going to have a problem at all with that aspect of this football game. One part of this game which should not go overlooked is the fact that a number of Michigan seniors will be putting on the uniform and the helmet for the final time.
I want to play my last game, the best game that I've ever had in my career, and to do that, I got to be focused and be ready to go.
Do you think you'll be somewhat emotional playing your final game in a Michigan uniform for the Rose Bowl and everything that's at stake?
I think I'll be very emotional out there, and, you know, it's
It's typical for a guy that's been around the program for such a long time, and his career is coming to an end. I mean, thinking that you'll never wear that winged helmet again and never wear that uniform, it's something that is definitely going to hit me. And, you know, hopefully it'll boost me to play a lot better than, you know, the best game I ever have.
That's a pretty emotional Michigan football player there, and you should know more than anybody what he's thinking and the other seniors who will play their final game are thinking about never wearing that uniform and helmet again.
It's the ultimate of Michigan to play your final game in the Rose Bowl. That means you've had great success. But no Michigan team has come into this game number one in the nation with a chance to win the national championship. And when Glenn Steele says he's going to cry, I promise you he will. Either way, winning or losing, he's going to have an emotional experience playing his last game at Michigan.
And you know, most people wouldn't think of those big, hulking lug linemen being very emotional.
As a matter of fact, those big lugs are the most emotional of them all. The other guys that have had all kinds of press and publicity and everything, they handle it pretty well. But those guys up front that you win with, they know how important the game is, and they are the most emotional of all players.
All right, Michigan and Washington State. Playing in the Rose Bowl here in Pasadena. That's our program for Bo Schembechler. I'm Don Shane. Happy New Year, everybody.